Gibson, continue broadcasting and monitoring all subspace frequencies.
Yes, sir.
They have locked in on us, Captain. Readings indicate definite laser weaponry. 60 seconds till they can be fired at us.
Our own deflector screens can handle anything they put at, I assume.
Of course, Captain.
Still no response, Captain.
Cease broadcasting, Lieutenant. Maintain surveillance of all frequencies.
Yes, sir.
Collision course, Captain. Impact in 10 seconds. Lasers preparing to fire.
Evasive maneuvers, Mr. Hansen.
Collision course again, Captain.
Apparently they don't like us.
Apparently. If this is the way everyone in the neighborhood reacts to strangers, it's no wonder all these worlds were destroyed.
They're persistent too, sir. The ship is returning again.
How long can they keep this up, Sonak?
I would estimate not more than 5 minutes, Captain. No laser device can continue to produce that level of power for long. Not without beginning to seriously malfunction. In addition, their repeated course changes are straining their power source and the structure of the ship itself.
Very well. When their weapons become inoperable, perhaps we'll be able to talk. Anything this time, Lieutenant Gibson?
Nothing, Captain, but that last transmission was very complex. Lots of information contained in that four-second burst.
They're telling their friends about us?
A distinct possibility, Captain.
Sir, the ship is attacking again.
This will be its last run, Captain. They are deliberately inducing an overload. All matter and antimatter fuel will be simultaneously converted to energy in 30 seconds when they are at their closest range to the Hannibal. At that distance, our shields will not be able to withstand the energy release.
Mr. Hansen, shields down.
Down, sir?
Transporter room, lock on to occupants of attacking ship.
Shields down.
Transporter's locking on.
Explosion in 10 seconds.
Got him.
Maximum warp and shields up.
Captain, I have them in transit. Shall I bring them in?
Transporter room? Keep them in transit until further orders. Security. Full detail to the transporter room.
Security, we're on our way.
Let's go. Mr. Hansen, you have the con. Continue monitoring and keep me informed.
Yes, sir.
I would advise extreme caution, Captain.
You have some new information?
Yes, my readings indicate we only beamed over 4 survivors out of 12.
You mean the others weren't killed by the ship exploding?
No, it seems that when the first crew members were transported off the ship, the others just died with remarkable suddenness. Their life readings vanished within milliseconds. Even violent death isn't normally so swift.
Let's go. We don't know what we're bringing aboard. Whoever or whatever these people are, destruction, including self-destruction, seems to be the way of life with all of them. All right, Mr. Webb, let's bring one of them in. Security phasers on stun. Don't hesitate to use them.
Number one coming in now, Captain.
I would estimate the alien to be unconscious, if it falls within humanoid parameters.
Keep back anyway, Doctor, just in case.
Of course, Captain.
Reams, Creighton, check for weapons.
All right, Dr. Sparrow, he's all yours. Security, go with the doctor. Don't hesitate to stun the alien at the first line of movement. Understood?
Yes, sir. Garcia, accompany the doctor.
Yes, sir.
It is difficult to know the alien's normal physical structure. But its injuries appear to be minor. This alien has one heart that is functioning at an accelerated rate. Again, it is difficult to know if this is normal. Captain, I will require the facilities of the ship's sick bay in order to ascertain more data about the aliens.
I understand, Doctor. As soon as...
It appears the alien has fallen into a shock-induced coma.
Everyone, get out, now!
Take the lieutenant down to surgery immediately. I will inform you of her condition as soon as possible.
Captain, the room is now safe to enter again.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Report to sick bay and keep me informed on Garcia's progress.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, you saw it coming, Sonak. How can we get the others on board and stop this from happening again?
Only to keep them unconscious, so they can't activate their devices.
You know what happened then?
I think so. There was a power buildup from a device buried deep within the being's body. Similar to the power buildup from the ships.
At least they're consistent. What activates the destruct device?
I'm not sure, but before the power started building, the alien started moving its mouth. I'm guessing that they have a small transmitter implanted in their teeth.
Transport is still online, sir. It's a little scorched, but working. All the aliens in transit are still there.
That's good news, I think. All right, people, listen up. We're going to try this again. I want you to monitor the alien's vitals at all times and to trust what the tricorder says, not how the alien looks or acts. If your readings give you the slightest indication that he's waking up, stun him again. Our job is to get him to the medical section to prevent him from vaporizing himself and us.
Yes, Ensign, what can I do for you?
I'm sorry to bother you, Dr. Crandall, but I felt I had to speak to you.
Well, that's perfectly all right. Won't you have a seat? For starters, how about telling me your name?
I'm sorry. My name is Davis, sir.
No need for the sir. I'm just a civilian, not an officer, Ensign.
I know, sir, but as a representative of the Council.
Only unofficially, as I'm sure you're aware, Ensign. But tell me, Miss Davis, what is it you wish to speak to me about? Much as I'd like to, I'm afraid getting you or myself shore leave is a little bit beyond my current capabilities.
I realize that, of course, sir. And I don't want you to think that I'm being disloyal to the captain in any way by coming to speak to you.
Of course not. In any case, one's ultimate loyalty is to the Federation itself, not to any one individual. So please feel free to be completely open and honest with me. Whatever you have to say will be just between us. Unless, of course, you were to tell me specifically otherwise. Please, go ahead. Why not begin by telling me more about yourself? How did you get onto Hannibal, for instance? I seem to recall being told that this was your first assignment out of the Starfleet Academy.
That's right, sir. I just graduated 3 months ago. I don't know how I happened to be assigned to the Hannibal. Luck of the draw, I imagine. Even so, it was quite an honor.
I'm sure it was. The Hannibal, after all, is a highly regarded vessel.
Well, my classmates were green with envy. There wasn't one that didn't want the chance to serve with Captain Navarro.
But you weren't counting on anything like this, were you?
No, I wasn't. This was supposed to be a strictly scientific mission. We were supposed to be back on Earth in only a few weeks. My fiancé graduated last year, and he's on the Krieger, and we were both scheduled to be on the Republic next year. His family knows Captain Hozshun, and... I'm sorry.
No need to be. Graduating from the Academy doesn't mean you have to stop being human.
Thank you, sir.
You have nothing to thank me for. Believe me, I know how you feel. I don't have a fiancé waiting for me at home, but I do have family and friends. You said you had to speak to me, Miss Davis. I hope you haven't changed your mind.
No, it's just that... As I understand it, you're an expert on the gravitational anomalies the Hannibal was investigating. The anomalies that got us where we are now.
I know a little bit about them, yes. I was in charge of the laboratory that developed the detectors that the Hannibal is now using.
I understand that you don't agree with the captain's assessment of our situation. And, well, I just wanted to know what you think our chances are. Based on your knowledge of the anomalies, do you think we can ever get back to the Federation?
I rather doubt it. Not at least under the present command structure.